Hi, I'm Sherry Crabtree, Horticulture Research and Extension Associate at Kentucky State University. Today, we're going to be touring the Pawpaw Orchards at the Harold R. Benson Research and Demonstration Farm at Kentucky State University. This orchard was planted in 2004, so it's 16 years old, and it contains the cultivars Sunflower and Susquehanna. So recommended spacing for pawpaw trees is 8 to 10 feet apart, and these are planted 8 feet apart. And you'll notice that the tree trunks are painted white, and this is to prevent a condition called southwest injury or sunscald, in which in the winter time the tree is dormant and the sun shines strongest on the southwest side of the trunk, and the dark color of the bark absorbs heat into the trunk and causes it to warm on that side and gets the sap flowing when it should be dormant for the winter. Then it gets cold again. So it's kind of a freeze-thaw cycle that causes cracking on that side of the trunk. So we paint these white. It's a mixture of 50-50 latex paint, white latex paint, and water that we spray the trunks with to reflect the light so the trunk doesn't absorb so much heat and it prevents southwest injury. Weed control is important in orchards. You don't want a lot of grass and weeds growing extremely close to your pawpaw trees. And you can achieve this by different methods. In this orchard, we usually use glyphosate. It's been a while since we have sprayed, since we're getting closer to harvest, so there has been quite a bit of regrowth of grass and weeds. Irrigation is important for pawpaw trees, especially in young trees, and especially during the summer, during the hottest parts of the summer. We use drip irrigation, so what you're seeing is a drip irrigation line. The reason we have it suspended in the air is because on the ground, one, they get clogged up with dirt and things on the ground, and two, it's easy to hit them with mowers and weed eaters when they're on the ground and cause leaks. So we hang up our drip irrigation lines so they're suspended over the ground. So we have two of these emitters per tree, drip irrigation emitters that are 1 gallon per hour emitters per tree. Of course, this is more for a larger orchard. If you have just a few trees in your yard, you just want to make sure that you water your trees regularly. You know, go out with your hose and water them a couple of times a week. Pawpaw trees need at least an inch of rain per week. So pawpaws are pretty free of most major insect and disease pests. The main thing that we see is Phyllosticta, which is a fungal disease. And you see the black spots on the fruit are lesions of this Phyllosticta fungus. So it's basically just cosmetic. It's just on the surface. That fruit was ripe, and when you cut into it, the inside is fine. It doesn't cause any kind of rot. It's just on the skin, which makes it, you know, less attractive to consumers if you're trying to sell pawpaw fruit. But it is usually just on the skin. However, in severe cases of it, it can cause the skin to crack. Basically, it makes the skin brittle, and as the fruit grows, it causes it to crack. So if your Phyllosticta infection is bad enough that it causes cracking on the fruit, then it would damage the fruit so that it wasn't edible. So we also see these Phyllosticta fungal spots on the leaves as well as the fruit. So we were looking at using copper and sulfur sprays and also some other fungicide sprays to control this, and that research is still in progress with a graduate student we have. So hopefully one of those will be useful for control of Phyllosticta. Pawpaw fruit ripen here in Kentucky starting in late August and going through about the end of September. So one thing that's about pawpaw fruit, they usually stay green even when they're ripe. You see these are starting to get slightly yellow, indicating they're getting close to being ripe, but really you have to touch them to see if they're ripe. Pawpaw fruit will be soft, starting to get soft when they're ripe, and they'll also come off easily in your hand. So if you give the fruit a little wiggle, a little gentle pull, if they were ready to pick, they would come off in your hand when they're ripe. So those are not quite ready to pick yet, even though they're starting to get a little bit yellow. But in a lot of fruit, they will be completely green even when they're ripe. And it's really just by touch. And also, they will drop on the ground when they're ripe. So if you see fruit on the ground around a tree, you know that the fruit are starting to get ripe on that tree. And you can pick them up off the ground if you beat the animals to them. We have raccoons and possums and groundhogs, all like to eat pawpaw fruit, so often you need to pick them out of the tree in order to beat the animals to them. You can pick them when they're just starting to get soft, but they have to be beginning the ripening process at least and be a little bit soft. And at that point, you can keep them in the refrigerator for longer storage or set them on the counter and let them ripen off the tree. However, if the fruit are completely hard, then they will not ripen off the tree. So they have to be starting to get soft, and at that point you can pick them and let them fully ripen off the tree. You probably notice in our orchard we don't have a lot of fruit on the trees. So we had a late spring freeze this year. The pawpaws all came into full bloom early. We had really warm temperatures in early spring, and the pawpaws all came into full bloom early. Then we had two nights in a row. We had 25 one night, 26 another night, that killed most of the flowers and developing fruit. Then some more later flowers came out, and then we got down to 27 and 28 a couple of weeks later. So that killed most of the flowers and developing fruit on our pawpaws. So we have very few fruit in our orchards or really anywhere around the area. Most growers in Kentucky don't have any fruit this year. And even in Indiana, North Carolina, Ohio, I've heard from growers that do not have fruit this year. So that's unusual with pawpaw. Usually they flower a little bit later and they flower over a long period of time, and they don't generally get completely wiped out by spring freezes. But this year it was kind of unlucky circumstances. We lost most of the crop. Pawpaws do not have to be pruned extensively. They naturally have kind of a bushy growth habit and will have a lot of low branches and just kind of a bushy shape. These trees are pruned similar to apple trees, so to a central leader type structure, where we selected strong scaffold branches that have good angles to them. You want wide angles to your branches, which makes them less prone to splitting and breaking. So these were pruned similar to an apple tree, not quite as intensively as apples have to be pruned. And then as they get bigger, we remove the central leader. We go in and cut that central leader at about 5 or 6 feet, just to keep the tree shorter and easier to harvest from. So that's called a modified central leader at that point. But pawpaws do tend to have a lot of low branches, which if you want a more naturalized look, it's fine to leave those, but they do get in the way of mowing and weed eating and harvesting fruit. So in an orchard setting, we tend to cut those out. That you want to look out for when you're pruning, you want to cut any branches that have a very narrow crotch angle, and any branches that are crossing and rubbing against each other, which this one is actually doing both. So where you have this narrow angle right here, that's going to be prone to, in a windstorm, breaking and splitting. And also how it's crossing and rubbing, it causes damage to the bark, which is basically a potential entry point for diseases. So anything that has extremely narrow angle like that, or is crossing and rubbing against other branches, you want to cut and remove. So pawpaws form flower buds for next spring, the summer before. So you can actually see the flower buds that this pawpaw is going to have next year. It's these round buds that are in the leaf axils. So the round buds are flower buds. The vegetative buds on pawpaw are pointed. So they form flower buds on new wood. So you see from that point on is the new growth from this year. And you can see the flower buds that will open next spring already. So sometimes you see fruit that are fused together like this. See how these fruit are stuck together? It's basically just the fruit did not separate correctly when they were forming. It's kind of like Siamese twins in humans, or like when you have webbed feet. It's just kind of a little anomaly in the fruit. But you do see that sometimes. We just call them Siamese twin pawpaws. But two fruits stuck together. This fruit also has a lot of phyllosticta that you notice, but that's something that people ask about sometimes, is when they see two fruits stuck together. So when pawpaw fruit are ripe and ready to pick, again, they're soft, so I'm squeezing this fruit and it's soft. This one had actually dropped to the ground. It was ripe and it fell to the ground, so it's actually a little bit bruised. So let's break open this fruit and see what it looks like inside. And you can see a slight yellow color to this fruit when it ripened, but not all fruit have that. So Let's break it open and look inside. So this one's a pretty light yellow color. Pawpaw fruit range from orange to yellow or even light yellow in color. So this one is a little bit lighter colored. But you can see the flesh is soft and custardy, kind of similar to a ripe avocado. And you do have these seeds inside. So this is, here's the pawpaw seeds. There's two rows of these large kind of lima bean shaped seeds inside, which the seeds and the skin are not edible. So you don't want to eat, the skin just has a bitter flavor to it. And the seeds are too large and hard to eat, obviously, but they also have alkaloid compounds in them that you don't want to eat. So you see how soft the flesh is when it's ripe. It's this really custardy texture to the flesh when it's ripe. This tree was bark inlay grafted, and bark inlay grafting is a method of top working is a term. So basically you have a large tree. If it's a seedling tree or a wild tree and doesn't produce very good fruit, you can cut that tree down. So basically cut it down to a stump, and then you take a stick from the tree that you want to propagate, and at the edge of that stump you graft that stick from the variety that you want to propagate on. So you see the remaining stump, that was the old tree, and so this was grafted 4 years ago. And so you see the amount of growth extremely fast that you get from a bark inlay graft. So that's just a method of changing over a variety that you don't want anymore, or a seedling that doesn't produce very good fruit, to a more desirable, high-producing variety. Pawpaws tend to send up a lot of shoots from the roots. They're called root suckers. Usually you want to remove those. So if it's on a tree, a healthy tree that is growing, usually want to cut the root suckers out, because they're not generally very productive. They grow vegetatively and don't produce a lot of fruit and take energy away from the parent tree. Also, if it's a grafted tree, the root suckers will not be the same variety as the top of the tree if the tree was grafted. But in some cases, it's not a bad thing that pawpaws send up shoots from the roots. This is a tree that died, that was cut down. You see the stump. And so shoots will come up from the roots, and we can keep these. You can choose the healthiest, strongest root sucker and remove the rest and let this grow into the new tree. So you can either wait and see what kind of fruit this has on it. It may have good fruit, even though it's a seedling. Or you can then graft onto this root sucker, graft a variety that you want to propagate onto that root sucker. You can also do bark inlay grafting onto branches instead of onto the main trunk of the tree. If you want to do graft multiple varieties onto the same tree, if you don't have room for more than one tree, you can graft a different variety onto one branch, and then you've got two different varieties in the same tree to cross-pollinate. So you can also do the same bark inlay grafting onto trunks of the tree, like you see here. And this one was performed last year, I believe. So you can see the growth from last year. And hopefully eventually this would grow enough that it will basically cover up the cut portion of the branch. So here are the potted pawpaw trees that we've started in the greenhouse. Pawpaws have a deep taproot, so you want to start them in pots that are deep like this. And the taproot will grow all the way to the bottom of the pot. So this has some air pruning in the bottom of the pot. So when you plant seeds, you want to plant them about an inch deep in the pot. And so once you start your seedling, you can either grow your seedling up and plant it out. But as we discussed earlier, seedlings take longer to produce fruit than grafted trees, and you don't know exactly what you're going to get. So we graft a lot of trees. This one was grafted. You can kind of see the scar on the tree right there where it was grafted several years ago. And so we graft some trees in the pots. We graft some trees in the field. And we'll leave them here in the greenhouse until they get to be at least 1.5 to 2 feet tall, and then we'll plant them out in the field. When they're under 1.5 feet tall, pawpaw seedlings need shade, so that's why we have shade cloth in this house to provide some shade to the young seedlings. When they get over 1.5 feet tall and you plant them out in the field, they can be planted in full sun.